Hello, I am Rakshith Shetty, a PhD student from India. I am pursuing my doctoral studies in geotechnical engineering at IIT Bombay, working under the supervision of Professor D.N. Singh of the Civil Engineering Department. As part of the great project funded by European Commission, I had an opportunity to be an intern at Porous Media Group of Laboratory Navier at École des Ponts Paris Tech in Paris, where I worked with Professor Philippe Cousut for a duration of over 3 months. I specifically worked to understand the rheological aspects of the fine-grained soils and clay minerals having consistency near liquid limit. From the conventional soil mechanics point of view, the fine-grained soils have been classified based on the Atterberg limits of shrinkage, plastic and liquid limits, which are qualitative in nature. They provide us with an idea of material behavior until liquid limit, where the shear stress is around 2 kPa. However, the tests and method to understand the behavior of these soils existing in consistency state greater than that of the liquid limit are few. The conventional testing instruments and protocols fail at such consistencies, as material response to stress is predominantly flow, like that of a liquid, rather than the deformation which is expected of a solid material. Several researchers have resorted to rheometry-based approach, wherein rheometers were used to study this behavior. These instruments are used to classify fluids based on their viscosity and yield stress response to the strain risk and time. The challenge in testing aggravates when the consistency is near to the liquid limit in the transition zone. The testing protocol adapted to the slurries with higher water content fails due to large shear stress that is required to yield the material. Such a state of material in transition zone is often found in offshore stope stability designs, landslides, mud flows, and mineral processing industries. The concentric cylinder geometry, which are used for testing of soil slurries, cannot be used in this case because of the limited range of yield stress that it could measure. Hence, the parallel plate geometry, which would enable testing of samples having yield stress over 10 kPa, has been used. To avoid the wall slip, profile geometry was used while testing such systems, which generally fall into the category of complex fluids. These fluids are the ones which could be classified or understood better in terms of their yield stress variation rather than viscosity. Conventionally, dynamic strain rate tests are carried out from which the flow curves are obtained, which are nothing but the plot of shear stress versus the shear rate. However, for soil slurries, which typically show shear thinning behavior, obtaining the yield stress and viscosity from back extrapolation of linear region of curve in higher strain rates leads to the erroneous value of yield stress. This is due to the uncertainty in the range of strain rates over which it could be determined. Also, it has to be noted that one could identify the yield stress by carrying out constant strain rate test at extremely low strain rates to obtain the most conservative or true measure of yield stress. The material in its solid regime having a jammed network of interconnected bonds, as seen in this figure, which is a typical graph of a constant strain rate test, would slowly start to break when it approaches the yielding phase. Later, to which the network would align in the direction of imposed strains, signaling the onset of plastic regime, when no further stress increment is observed. The corresponding stress over this plateau region could be taken as yield stress, which in this figure corresponds to a value of 1200 pascals. The constant strain rate test has advantage that the flow cost would be homogeneous in nature in the solid regime until the end of yield zone. Thus, this point, which is also the beginning of the plateau region, could be taken as the true measure of yield stress. Once the material enters the plastic stage, flow instabilities in the form of local fractures may lead to distorted interpretation of the yield stress value. Thus, constant strain rate tests would also be helpful in situations where one has an idea of strain rates that could be encountered in practical situation of concern, such that those strain rates could directly be used to obtain the yield stress value. I thank Professor D.N. Singh, Professor Philippe Cousut, Professor Jean-Michel Pereira and Professor Alessandro Tarantino for sharing their views and thoughts and giving me the opportunity to work on this topic of interest through the great project.